Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulihi Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Welcome to another episode of Juz by Juz. And inshallah, we're looking at Juz number 8 today. Once again, we pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us in this month of Ramadan and accept all our good deeds. So Juz number 8 consists of two major surahs, two major chapters of the Quran. One is that it concludes the surah that we started yesterday, that is Suratul An'am. And then we commence a segment, a portion of Surat Al-A'raf. So the juz begins with verses of Suratul An'am, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes a mention of some of the objections that were raised by the disbelievers. As we said yesterday, that all of the Makki surahs, their themes are generally around three major topics: Tawheed, the oneness of God; Risalah, the prophethood of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and him being a genuine, true, authentic prophet, as well as the reality and the belief, our creed, in reference to the Ma'ad, the next life, the Akhirah, the forthcoming life. So there were many objections that were raised by the disbelievers, and these objections are being answered to. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then explains here in the opening verses of Juz number 8, Shayateen al-insi wal-jinn. You will find that there are devils from both the jinn kind as well as the humankind. And the reason why the Almighty makes a mention of this is the objections that were being raised against the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, against the concept of one God, against the reality of Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, being a true, genuine prophet receiving revelation from the Almighty, as well as the denial of the next life, the objections were being raised, and these were inspired by devilish activities and devilish thoughts, again, to deny and to reject. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warns us here in these opening verses of Juz number 8, that you will find that there are devils, there are shayateen, al-jinni wal-ins, from amongst the jinn, from amongst the jinn kind, which the human generally cannot see, and also the human beings. And who are the jinn, who are the shayateen of the humans? Those that tell others to turn away from the truth. Those that make hurdles and obstacles for establishing justice and good activities on the face of this earth. Then Allah directs our attention as the juz continues, إِن يَتَّبِعُونَ إِلَّا الظَّنِّ. And Allah talks about a very important factor here, that what leads a person many a times to becoming astray is that they follow their logic, their reason, their conspiracy that is within their thought process against what Allah and the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, have established. So you have the law and the legislation of God, what he has said, in reference to, for example, him being the one and only. Now, if in our thought process or our temptations or desires, or we just feel like it, that we feel that there's more than one God, how can there be more than one, how can there be only one God? So we have this thought process, and then we begin to follow it, and it's contrary to what God, what Allah and the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, has established. So Allah says here, إِن يَتَّبِعُونَ إِلَّا الظَّنِّ. This is one of the problems of those people who have become misguided, is that they follow conjecture, they follow their thought process, they follow their desires and their lust, even when it goes in against what Allah has established and what the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, has established. Now, because Suratul An'am speaks about animals, cattle, and various types of animals, and what was some of the activities that the mushrikun of Mecca were doing when it came to these animals. They were assigning portions of their slaughter in the name of idols, etc. So Allah is speaking about their activities, how because their foundation is based on shirk, on worshiping multiple gods, now their devotional acts will also be dedicated to these multiple gods, which has led them astray. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about now what is the proper etiquette and the rulings in reference to animals. Animals are a creation of God. We have to honor them, we have to respect them. Once the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, saw some of his companions playing around with a bird, with a sparrow, and they were using it as a target. It was alive and they were using it as a target to practice their target. When the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, saw this, he said, we are not permitted by God to hurt any living creature. Similarly, there was a companion or two who had come to visit the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him. They had traveled a fair amount of a distance. They were on their conveyances, on their animals. And when they arrived in Medina to converse and communicate, dialogue with the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, they stood on their animals, they sat on their animals. And the Prophet ﷺ said, فَارْكَبُوهَا صَالِحَةً وَتُرُكُوهَا صَالِحَةً. Just because they are mute, they're unable to communicate to us sometimes what their feelings are, it doesn't mean we take advantage of these animals. Rather, ride them with decency and with good morals. And when it's time to let them free and let them graze and let them rest, then that should be given to them because this is their right. The point I'm making is, what are the rulings in reference to animals? We honor them and respect them as a creation of God. Allah has permitted certain animals that we can consume. So here in these verses of Juz number 8 in Suratul An'am, Allah says, فَكُلُوا مِمَّا ذُكِرَ اسْمُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ. Those animals, those cattle, those sheep, goats, cows, chicken, etc. These type of animals we are permitted to eat. So Allah says, when you slaughter them to consume, then dedicate them only for Allah. And that's why when we slaughter an animal, we say, Bismillahi Allahu Akbar, in the name of God. This is in the name of God. He's given me the permission. This is taking life of an animal, and we are not permitted to take the life of any creature. So when we say Bismillah, we are saying that, oh God, you have given me permission to consume this animal. So I bless it with your name, and I thank you for providing this for me, that it is a source of my nourishment. So, the point that is being made here is, when you slaughter, فَكُلُوا مِمَّا ذُكِرَ اسْمُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ. Take the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Allah speaks about these rules, and then he says, وَلَا تَأْكُلُوا مِمَّا لَمْ يُذْكَرِ اسْمُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ. That those animals that have been dedicated for idols, for deities other than God, then do not consume them. Because a believer, a true Muslim, will only consume those animals that are based on tawheed, that are based on the oneness of Allah, dedicated solely for him. As we move on in the surah, Suratul An'am, in Juz number 8, Allah once again directs our attention towards some of those questions that were posed to the Prophet ﷺ to irritate him. Their attitude, because they didn't want to accept. And this generally happens. If someone gives us an instruction and we like it, we want to follow it, then we will adhere to it. We won't ask too many questions. We won't object. We won't cause a problem. But if someone instructs me to do something that I'm uneasy about, I'm not comfortable about, I don't know about, I will ask questions. And then another level is that someone asks me to do something that I don't want to do. So then I will ignore it. I will actually put it down and say that I don't want to do this and reject it. So this is exactly what was happening with the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him. He was inviting them towards the truth. He was making the da'wah and calling them towards the oneness of God. Remember, this is a Makki surah. For 13 years, he spent time day in, day out, and inviting them towards believing in one God, towards believing in the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, as the final messenger, as well as the final day, the day of judgment and the life after death. But they kept denying, they kept rejecting, they intensified in their disagreement, in their rejection and their disobedience. So they raised concerns to irritate the Prophet ﷺ. So one of the things that is being mentioned in the surah is they said, حَتَّى نُؤْتَى مِثْلَ مَا أُوتِيَ رُسُلُ اللَّهِ, that we won't believe until Allah also reveals to us. You're saying, Muhammad ﷺ, you're saying that a revelation has come to you. We will only believe in that revelation if God reveals a revelation to us as well. So you see how ridiculous claims they are making, and again to irritate and to deny and reject. So Allah responds to this objection of theirs and many others here. And he says, look, when it comes to revelation, you do not choose who's going to receive revelation. We cannot just wake up one day and say, I want to be a prophet. Allah selects prophets. He is the Inna Allah astafa Adam wa Nuha wa Ala Ibrahim wa Ala Imran ala al-alamin. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I select who is going to be a prophet. That is my choice. And Allah has selected as the final prophet Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, peace and blessings upon him. Moving on, Allah once again directs our attention towards Tawheed, the oneness of God. And as I've been saying, that Suratul An'am revolves around some of the jahiliyyah activities, some of the ignorant activities that were enshrined and based in the principles of shirk and associating partners with God. They were doing these activities, dedicating portions of their animals in service to their deities. So what were they saying? جَعَلُوا لِلَّهِ مِمَّا ذَرَأَ مِنَ الْحَرْثِ وَالْأَنْعَامِ نَصِيبًا فَقَالُوا هَذَا لِلَّهِ بِزَعْمِهِمْ وَهَذَا لِشُرَكَائِنَا. So what they would do is they would have vegetation at the end of their harvest, and they would take out portions. They would take a portion for God, and they would say, we would distribute this to the poor in the name of God. So that was decent, that was fine. But then they would take a larger portion out, and they would say, we are distributing this to the poor in the name of our idols. هَذَا لِشُرَكَائِنَا. This is in service and in obedience, in loyalty to our shuraka, to our idols and our deities that we worship. And then similarly, al-an'am, from their cattle, from their animals, when they would slaughter, they would say, from every third slaughter that we have, it's going to be distributed to the poor, the meat of that animal, in the name of our idols, and a small portion for God. In fact, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about سَأَمَا يَحْكُمُونَ. Allah speaks about how their judgment in reference to how they dedicate to God is also based on injustice. That many a times they give the shorter portion, the smaller portion in dedication to God, and then others to the idols, etc. And then sometimes they mismatch it and they don't even give a portion for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or they don't even give a portion to their idols. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, سَأَمَا يَحْكُمُونَ. They have no understanding, they don't know what they're doing, and their activities are based on ignorance. It's not based on knowledge. Whenever we want to adhere to a religion or a criteria of spirituality, it has to meet two criteria Allah makes a mention of here. One is that it has to be logical, it has to make sense. And number two is it has to be munazzalam min as-sama. It has to come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It has to be a revelation. When these two things are there, then it is deen. Otherwise, something that may be logical, but it doesn't confirm with what God has stated. Similarly, in some occasions, they are following what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, but then they incorporate their logic as well. So there has to be an infusion of both reason coupled with the verses or the revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala now speaks about the various blessings that Allah has given. And what's the address, and what's the lesson, and what's the reflection for you and I here, and especially for these Meccans who are worshipping multiple gods and dedicating these portions of their vegetation and their harvest or their cattle to their deities. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, look, you are honoring those deities who are false gods, believing and perceiving that they control the earth, or they have some share in how things operate around you. So you fear that they may not be happy and therefore there would be bad luck or a negative consequence for you. So you have to appease those so-called goddesses and gods or those idols and deities. The Almighty says that it's only me. It's only me that controls the earth and beyond of everything around you. And Allah reminds us in these verses. He begins by telling us about the gardens and the vegetation. Jannatin ma'rushatin wa ghayra ma'rushat. Allah says, look at these gardens and these orchards that are around you. You water them, it's the same water, but some come out green, with greenery, some have diverse colors. When it comes to your fruits and vegetables, they're different in size, they're different in taste, all from the same water, from the same earth, but there's so much diversity in the final product. Allah says, who's doing this? Is it your idols? Is it your spirits and your deities that you believe in? Or is it the Supreme Being, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is operating this and who is monitoring this and who has created this whole system and whose control everything is under? So Allah reminds us about this and says that you only will come up with one answer, and that is, it's only Allah. So if it is only Allah, He is the only one entitled to worship. So the concept of Tawheed being emphasized here in this segment of the verses. Allah then continues and talks about the correct position that we should have in reference to what is forbidden and what is not forbidden. Because what they would say is, they would say, every fifth animal is forbidden for us, we have to dedicate it to our idols. They would say, this portion of the animal we're permitted to eat, but this portion of the animal we cannot eat because it's dedicated again to their idols. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala clarifies on the tongue of the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, قُلْ, say to them, say to these Meccans, say to these Quraysh, and these mushrikun, these idolaters, and these followers of other deities other than Allah, say to them, لا أجد فيما أوحي إلي محرما على طاعم يطعمه إلا أن يكون ميتا أو دما مسفوحا أو لحم خنزير فإنه رجس أو فسقا أهل لغير الله به فمن اضطر غير باغ ولا عاد فلا إثم عليه. So Allah says to the Prophet ﷺ, say to them, this is exactly what is forbidden upon you. ميتا, a dead carcass. Dama masfuha, blood. We're not permitted to consume blood. We're not permitted to consume an animal that has died its natural death. We have to slaughter it. Then only it becomes permitted, and it has to be an animal in the category that Allah has permitted for us. Similarly, the verse continues and talks about khinzir. The swine is forbidden. Any animal that is dedicated for other than Allah. فَمَنِ اضْطُرَّ غَيْرَ بَاغٍ. Yes, if someone is in a dire circumstance where they're in the middle of a desert and there's nothing to eat and they're gonna die, that's the only situation where something forbidden becomes permissible. When we're in a life and death situation, there's nothing else to eat, so in that situation Allah lays down two conditions. فَمَنِ اضْطُرَّ غَيْرَ بَاغٍ وَلَا عَادٍ. As for the one who is in a dire necessity, غَيْرَ بَاغٍ وَلَا عَادٍ, they should not enjoy the forbidden. They have to consume it to survive, so they're going to consume it, but they're not going to enjoy it. And number two is, they're not going to consume what is beyond necessary. الضرورة تتقدر بالضرورة. The fiqh principle is very clear. The principle in jurisprudence is that when there's a necessity, then the flexibility is to the limit of the necessity. The flexibility is to the limit of the necessity. But other than this dire circumstance of life and death, these are the things that are made forbidden. Not what you follow out of your conjecture. يَتَّبِعُونَ إِلَّا الظَّنِّ. You are only following your thought process, and it's not based on revelation. As we continue in the juz number 8, Surah Al-An'am highlights the 10 commandments. We've talked about this before as well in the commencement. And these 10 commandments are in the Torah, they're in the Injil, they're in the previous revelations, as well as in the Quran. And you will find it in the Surah, Surah Al-An'am. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala specifically says, أَلَّا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا. Do not associate partners with Allah. Do not murder. do not commit adultery or fornication, do not consume and usurp the wealth of others that is not rightful for you, such as the wealth of orphans, etc. Like this, the Ten Commandments are highlighted, and Allah says in the segment of these verses that this is what God commands. This is wasayna bih. This is what we instruct. And it comes from the word wasiyya, which shows an emphasis here. It's not simply a command. It's an emphasized command from the Almighty. So we need to abstain from these evil acts and ensure that we stay within the framework of what is godly, what is pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As the verses continue in the juz, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then highlights the story and the narrative of Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam and reminds us that if you want to follow a path of tawheed, follow the path of tawheed of Abraham, Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. And this is how the surah concludes, and then we will start the next surah. So Suratul An'am is now coming to a conclusion in Juz number 8. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala highlights Abraham, Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. And one of the things that Allah says here about Ibrahim is look how dedicated he was on the path of the oneness of God. How dedicated and committed he was on the path of worshipping and being loyal to the one and only the Almighty. Putting Allah first. That's the message for us. Putting Allah first. And what did Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam say? He said in his famous statement, قُلْ إِنَّنِي هَدَانِي رَبِّي إِلَى صِرَاطٍ مُسْتَقِيمٍ دِينًا قِيَمًا مِلَّةَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ حَنِيفًا وَمَا كَانَ مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ إِنَّ صَلَاتِي وَنُسُكِي وَمَحْيَايَ وَمَمَاتِي لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ إِنَّ صَلَاتِي وَنُسُكِي My prayer, my sacrifice. إِنَّ صَلَاتِي وَنُسُكِي وَمَحْيَايَ وَمَمَاتِي My living and also my dying. لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ It's only for and solely for the Almighty. Meaning any prayer I do, it's dedicated to Him. Any devotional act of sacrifice that I render, it's only for the Almighty. And my living and my dying, meaning every movement I make, every decision I make, every enjoyment I have in life, it's based on what Allah has said, so therefore it's dedicated to Him. And even my death is upon the oneness of God, meaning that my final moments will also remain up to this, and that will result in my success of this world as well as in the hereafter. So Allah is refuting shirk that the disbelievers of Mecca were engaged in doing. As I've been emphasizing, the Prophet ﷺ for a period of 13 years is teaching the Tawheed. So Allah is supporting him by these narratives and giving him the ammunition in terms of the verses to respond to the objections and to deny the concept of shirk and associating gods with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as the surah comes to a conclusion, Allah reminds us, and I've been saying that the last verse of every surah, the last few verses of every chapter, they highlight the summary of the chapter. So what does Allah say in the last verse? وَهُوَ الَّذِي جَعَلَكُمْ خَلَائِفَ الْأَرْضِ Allah has made you vicegerents on this earth, meaning He's made us representatives of Him. And Allah says, وَرَفَعَ بَعْضَكُمْ فَوْقَ بَعْضٍ دَرَجَاتٍ Some of you are above one another. Some of you are prophets. Some of you are in a leadership position. Some of you are a family in a situation where you have children and you have family. Others, you may not be in a situation of an extended family. Some of you have a lot of blessings of merchandise, business and trade. Others don't. Some people have sicknesses. Others don't. Allah says, I've made you all vicegerents and my representatives. I've given you different positions, different resources. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ The reason why I've done this is to put you under trial and test. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ رَبَّكَ لَسَرِيعُ الْعِقَابِ وَإِنَّهُ غَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is very swift at taking accounts, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ever forgiving. And what this means is that whatever you do, Allah will take you to task for that. And the second thing is Allah saying He is very merciful and forgiving. He's very merciful and forgiving. So if you have strayed from the path, if you have strayed away and become diverted from your objectives based upon my teachings and the teachings that are revealed to the prophets, then come back, repent, turn back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah will embrace you wholeheartedly. So this was the message given to the Meccans, that you have spent a considerable amount of time in your shirk and associating partners with God, but there still is a chance. Accept Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, as the final messenger. Accept that there's only one God, and believe that there is resurrection after life, and lead a life that is pleasing to God, and you will be forgiven. You will be raised in your ranks before the Almighty, and given the best of this world as well as in the hereafter. So that concludes Surah Al-An'am. Now we're moving on to Surah Al-A'raf, and this is the chapter that follows. The interesting thing is that it's also a Mekki surah. And it's what this means, it was revealed to the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, in the period where he had not migrated to Medina as yet. And as we have been saying, that every Makki surah has the message of belief in one God, the reality and the truthfulness of the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, being a genuine prophet, as well as the reality of life after death. So what does A'raf mean? A'raf refers to a certain level or a certain height. And in a technical sense here, in the context of the Quran, it refers to a level between paradise and between hell. So it's an intermediary level. It's in between the paradise and the hellfires. Because this surah speaks about the dialogues that will happen on the Day of Judgment between these three categories of people, between the inhabitants of paradise, the inhabitants of the hellfire, and those who have not been given a decision or a declaration as to where they're going to end up, either the paradise or either the hellfire. So that is known as the A'raf and the Ashabul A'raf, the people of A'raf, the people of the heights between paradise and between hellfire. Most ulama and scholars say this is in reference to those people who had a lot of resources, a lot of blessings from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah is extending their hisab. Allah is extending their interrogation. If He wants, He can swiftly take their interrogation. As Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha makes a mention that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he would often make dua, Allahumma hasibni hisaban yaseeran. Oh Allah, give me a very easy hisab. Give me a very easy interrogation. And oh Allah, protect me hisaban asira, from a very difficult hisab. So Aisha says, I asked the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, what's the difference between the easy accountability and the easy interrogation versus the difficult interrogation? So the Prophet ﷺ responded by saying that for those whom Allah wants to forgive, Allah won't ask much. Allah will just say, okay, you did your prayers, you did what you had to, you tried your best, you're going to Jannah. The other one where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, okay, on this specific day, you did this specific action. Answer to me about that. Why did you engage in doing it? At this specific time, so details, an audit, an interrogation on a detailed matter. And that's an indication that this person will not succeed. It's very similar to an audit or an inspection. You have some people who are inspectors, and when they see that things are looking decent, they just do a external glance on the surface. They're not getting into too much details of the books, etc. But when they see that, okay, something seems fishy here, now they go into the specific details. They're interrogating, they're getting further into it. So when that begins to happen, then a person begins to realize that I'm going to be exposed. There's going to be some difficulty here and challenging circumstance here. So that's the same criteria here. Hisaban yaseera. We need to ask Allah for an easy hisab. So the people of A'raf, some of them will be those who are interrogated and given a hisab very extensively, which results in them staying in the A'raf and they're not being given a decision of either paradise or hellfire. Then as this surah, another name of this surah, another name for this chapter is called Suratul Miqat. And why is this? Because Miqat means an appointment. Miqat refers to a specified time. And the reason why this surah is called Suratul Miqat as well is because in this chapter, Allah speaks about a number of meetings that Musa alayhi salatu wasalam had with the, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the word Miqat is actually in this surah, in this chapter, when, for example, Musa alayhi salatu wasalam was invited to the Mount Sinai, the Mount Tur, and he was given the tablets. This was a specified time. He had to stay there for 40 days and then extended to another 10 or 20 days. So Allah highlights this in this surah and speaks about these scheduled appointments or these scheduled meetings with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And therefore, this is the reason why this surah is also titled Suratul Miqat. Another name for the surah, Suratul A'raf, is known as Suratul Mithaq. And Mithaq means a covenant, a promise, a commitment. And why is this surah called Suratul Mithaq? Is because in this chapter, in this surah, Allah speaks about the Mithaqu Ahdi Alast. And what that means is the covenant that every soul made, you and I made, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when He created us. When He created us, He asked us a question. Alastu bi rabbikum? Am I not your Lord? قَالُوا بَلَى. They said, for sure you are our Lord. They said, yes, definitely you are our Lord. So as souls, we all declared in Tawheed and we made this commitment that we will surrender to Him when we come onto this earth. Some people live up to that covenant and others don't. So this is a little background about the name. Now, as I said, it's a Makki surah, so the themes are related to Tawheed. There's no ahkam, there's no rulings, and there's no Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu. There's no address specifically to the believers or the hypocrites, etc., because this all happens in Medina after migration. Now, there is a mention in the hadith that this surah was often recited by the Prophet ﷺ in Salatul Maghrib. When he would lead the Maghrib prayer, he would recite some of the verses of Suratul A'raf. According to one report, half the surah in the first rak'ah and half the surah in the second rak'ah, second unit of prayer. So this shows that the Prophet ﷺ stayed connected with this chapter, excuse me, and this surah. The themes are very similar to Suratul An'am, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about aqeedah and reforming our belief system and our articles of faith. The difference, if we are to give it, there's a slight or a very fine distinction between An'am and A'raf, even though the themes are very similar. The slight variation is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the creed in Suratul An'am in light of the jahiliyyah and the ignorant works that the mushrikun were doing, as well as the life of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Whereas in Suratul A'raf, Allah speaks about our creed and the correct aqidah in light of the previous prophets and their communities. And that's why there's a number of prophets and their stories that are mentioned with tafsil, meaning with detail, with description. And who are these prophets? Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam, Hud, Salih, Lut, Shu'aib, and Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. And in particular, a lot of details about the Prophet Moses, the Prophet Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. In fact, commentators have dissected the surah and they found 10 episodes from the life of the Prophet Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. Again, the idea is that we learn from these previous prophets, their communities, the final outcome about them, and we do the positive that they've done, and we refrain from the negatives that they engaged in doing. There are specifically two methodologies Allah adopts in this surah to remind us about the messages and the reflections in this chapter. The first is what we call tadhkir, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us that I've blessed you with this, I've created you, I've made you, I've given you health, wealth, prosperity, I've created everything around you, the whole system, the economic system, the ecological system, whatever you require for survival, I'm the sole creator for it. So tadhkir. So when we are reminded that Allah is the one who is giving us all of this, then it should leave us with no option but to surrender to Him, to prostrate to Him. And the other message is tahweef. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warns us that, look, if you don't abide by the revelation that is being revealed to Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, then there are punishments for you. The warnings about punishments in this world, as well as the devastating punishments in the next life. Then Allah also highlights some of the discussions of the people of paradise, the people of hellfire, and also the people in between, known as the A'raf, as I highlighted earlier. Allah then, again in this surah, speaks about not taking ourselves to our own destruction by denying the truth. Allah also speaks about the fact that we will all be put under tests and trials. And the purpose and the objective of these tests and trials is to turn to Allah, is to become aware that He is in power, and to prostrate and to surrender to Him. And also an important note on the fact that we should always remember the Almighty, be aware and mindful of Him. So beginning of this surah, in Juz number 8, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the Qur'an, لِتُنذِرَ بِهِ وَذِكْرَ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ, that this Qur'an, this kitab, this Qur'an is to warn you of the warnings, and also to give you a reminder, and it is only the believers that will accept this reminder. And then moving on, Allah speaks about the Day of Judgment, that it's a reality, it will take place, the mizan, وَالْوَزْنُ يَوْمَئِذٍ الْحَقِّ. Allah says in this surah, in suratul A'raf, that the Day of Judgment, that mizan, that scale is truth. You're gonna be, your deeds are gonna be weighed. So prepare yourselves for that day. Then Allah gets right into the story of the creation story, as we call it, how humans were created. And there are two reasons for this that Allah speaks about this here. One is reminding us of our origins, that this is where you came from. And the other, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us that I'm your creator. So surrender to me. Those idols, those deities, etc., are not your creators. They're not your makers. They can neither benefit you nor harm you. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us about the story of Adam, that he was created. Angels were told to prostrate. Iblis denied. Again, the reason here is Allah is asking us, be aware of your enemy. Iblis, the devil, denied to prostrate because of arrogance and because of jealousy. The two qualities we need to stay away from is jealousy and arrogance, or else that will lead us to misguidance. As we proceed further in the surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the dialogues that take place between the people of hellfire, paradise, and the A'raf. وَنَادَى أَصْحَابُ الْأَعْرَافِ رِجَالًا. Allah then speaks about وَنَادَى أَصْحَابُ الْجَنَّةِ أَصْحَابَ النَّارِ وَنَادَى أَصْحَابُ النَّارِ أَصْحَابَ الْجَنَّةِ. So each one of these categories of people, the inhabitants of paradise, the inhabitants of the hellfire, and the inhabitants of the A'raf, the heights, they will have the capacity somehow to communicate with one another. And Allah is recording some of the communication that will take place. What will the people of paradise say? They will say, وَجَدَنَا مَا وَعَدَنَا رَبُّنَا حَقَّ. Whatever Allah had promised, we engaged in doing, in following, in adhering to the prophets and the teachings. Whatever Allah had promised in return of that, we witnessed it, and we're enjoying it in Jannah, in paradise. And the people in hellfire, they will be blaming one another, that it's you that misguided us. They will say, no, you made your own choice. And then Allah will say, all of you, لِكُلِّن فِي النَّارِ. All of you are in the hellfire because you didn't adhere to what the message that was revealed to you. And then Allah speaks about the A'raf. When the people in the heights, when they turn to the people of paradise, they will long, they will say, oh Allah, I want to be with the people of paradise. And they will say to the people of paradise, we want to join you. And when they look at the people of the hellfire, they will say they want to abstain, and they will refrain from entering the hellfire. So Allah speaks about these dialogues. And again, the reminder is, that is the Day of Judgment. It will occur. So prepare yourselves. May Allah make us amongst those who are the Ashabul Jannah, the people of paradise. And as the surah or the juz comes to a conclusion, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us the example of the true believer and a disbeliever. And Allah highlights this with an example. بَلَدُ الطَّيِّبِ وَالَّذِي خَبُثِ. That you have a piece of land that is positive. It's very fertile. It brings about vegetation. The rains come and we can harvest when the vegetation comes out. Allah says that's the example of a believer. There's always positive activities. They're always helping others. They're always charitable. They're always kind. They're always in obedience to Allah. Baladu tayyib. It's like a positive, fertile piece of land. And as far as the disbeliever or the one who rejects Allah and who is engaged in evil deeds, وَالَّذِي خَبُثْ, it's like a piece of land that is not fertile. There's weeds there. There's insects and reptiles that have infested. And we try to grow something there. It doesn't grow properly. It doesn't result in the objectives that a farmer would have. And it is rather a nuisance and an irritation. So Allah says that is the example of a disbeliever. As the Juz comes to an end, Allah highlights the story of five prophets. Nuh alayhi salatu wassalam, Hud alayhi salatu wassalam, Salih alayhi salatu wassalam, Lut alayhi salatu wassalam, and Shu'ayb alayhi salatu wassalam. The details of these stories you know, or you can read in the Juz, but in essence there is one message. These prophets, they came to their communities. Some of these communities, they were in majority. Some of them had wealth and prosperity. Some of them had vegetation. Some of them had physical strength. Allah says they were given so much. But when the Prophet came with the truth and the revelation, majority of them denied. They were arrogant about what they had, but the end result was they were destroyed. The end result was they were losers. So Allah reminds us to reflect that we should not be amongst those who follow their lifestyle, who were the losers. Rather, adhere to the message of the Prophets and be the successful ones. So this concludes Juz number 8. We make dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala empower us with the true meanings of this Juz and the two surahs that we looked at, Suratul An'am as well as Suratul A'raf. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep us connected with the message of the Quran and grant us the best of success. Jazakumullahu khayran. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh.